Haití, Haiti, Afghanistan, much before September 11th, now Afghanistan is vital for everybody, even for me. We have 1,200 people in Afghanistan now, soldiers, but in last spring. Anyway, I come to my conclusion. We don't really exist in this country. I don't feel hurt or humiliated. I'm just stating a fact. Now, as I said, Spain belongs to the European Union, and we entered the European Union in 85. And as you know, the European Union is the largest economic bloc in the world. It should be by now a political bloc, but and it is to a certain extent, but politically still the European Union is not a grown-up, it's still a teenager. Well, economically, we are already a grown-up. We have a GNP which is comparable to that of the United States, and we are an important economic bloc. And at the moment, Spain is holding the presidency of the European Union. Now I will say something about the relationship between the European Union and the United States and the way the United States is seen in or are seen in the in Europe. The United States and the European Union, the 15 countries of the European Union, which is, as you know, France, Germany, Italy, Great Britain, Spain, Belgium, Holland, Luxembourg, Finland, Sweden, Portugal, Greece, and Austria, they share many things. They look at the world in a similar way, more or less. But at the same time, very often, they have different interests. At the United Nations, for example, though we have the same values, we have the same values, the same, we believe the same about democracy, about the play, the way market should play in relationship in society, about the not being intolerant, for example, in religion, about human rights. Though we have more or less exactly the same beliefs. However, quite often in the United Nations, we don't behave the same. I could mention many cases where the United States and the, United Na- and the European Union differ in the United Nations, but I will mention only two or three in order not to bother you. The first one is what I said at the beginning, that we pay promptly, fully, and without condition. Something that the United States don't. The United States usually has some attachment, some conditionality, some bellmark or benchmark, or whatever you call it, and they procrastinate when the moment to pay comes. That puts the United Nations in a very difficult position because Mr. Kofi Annan, sometimes he looks like a magician, but he cannot produce money at night. So he needs the money of the member states. And the biggest contributor to the United Nations is the United States. If the United States don't pay on time, Mr. Annan and the things that the United Nations have to do around the world, they suffer. And they suffer so much that quite often Mr. Annan has to resort to very funny procedures in order to keep the machinery going. In so funny procedures that in my country, if a department of the government, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, where I was undersecretary in a time, we did that, we would have trouble. We would have trouble because any inspection unit that saw what we were doing, we would say that it was quite irregular. For example, if the United States owes to the United Nations an amount of money that represents more or less the budget of the whole year of the United Nations, and that's what the United States owed 7 months ago, before September 11, with September 11, finally they paid $600 million. If the United States owed this amount of money, Mr. Nan has to keep the machinery going. And what does he do? What does he do? He borrows money from the budget of what we call the peacekeeping operation. The United Nations has to budget, the normal budget, to function, to perform, to work, and then has another budget to pay the peacekeeping operation. In other words, to pay the countries that lend troops to the United Nations to keep peace in the world. Okay? Since the United States is not paying, then Kofi Annan has to take money from the peacekeeping operation budget in order to pay the interpreter of the United Nations, in order to pay the light, the utilities, in order to pay the policeman, in order to his own salary. And then what happens? The countries that are lending the troops to the United Nations, Jordan, Pakistan, Morocco, Bolivia, Sweden, who are supposed to receive the money from the United Nations, they cannot receive the money because the United States have not paid. In other words, Pakistan is financing the United States, which is a little bit of a blasphemy, in my opinion. Pakistan, with I don't know how many dollars income per capita you have?
470.
How much?
470.
A country with $470 per capita is financing the richest and the most powerful country in the world. It's an irony and even a blasphemy. So the European Union says that all countries should pay promptly, fully, in both conditions. We disagree with the Americans on that. Another thing we disagree is quite often, not deeply, but at least slightly, in a very vital matter in the Middle East. In the Middle East, the United States has an approach closer to Israel than we have. We try to be more equidistant from Israel and the Palestine, and there not always we were hand in glove with the United States. And there are some other matters, for example, human rights. We agree with the American on the substance completely. We denounce and we try to promote the respect of human rights in the world. But the way we have to handle the situation is not, we don't always agree with the United States. To give you an example, the United Nations have a commission called the Commission of Human Rights, whose venue is in Geneva. This commission is composed by some 53 or 54 members who keep an eye on how the human rights are respected in the world. So, to be in this commission, you have to be voted. You have to be voted. You run a campaign, and then they vote for you, or they don't vote for you. But that's democracy in the United Nations. Last year, the United States ran a campaign, and it was defeated. It was defeated. They ran with in the same group, because in the United Nations, when you run a campaign for something, you fight inside your geographical group. And the United States are inside what we call the WEOG, Western European and Other State, which means the countries of Western Europe, New Zealand, Australia, Canada, the United States, Israel, and I don't know who else. Anyway, these are the group, our group. When you run for some body in the United Nations, you run inside your group. You don't run, the United States don't run against Morocco. Spain don't run against Bolivia. And Sweden don't run against Pakistan. You run in your group. Your group has two or three seats allocated, and then you run in your group. Last year, the United States ran against France, Sweden, and Austria for three seats. Because the United States did a very poor campaign, and because the other did an excellent campaign, and because since the United States was not paying at the time, and people were fed up, because people say, why in this club the member